Good morning, church. I love having this thing that happens where we're starting and everyone's still talking and there's so much conversation, and it's really awesome to hear that again. It just makes my heart really happy. A couple of announcements this morning before we start our worship. Pastor Robert and Teresa are on vacation visiting some family. I think it was Teresa's first time off since the pandemic started, so we're glad that she got some time. We have many things coming up in the next couple of weeks. First off, tonight at 6, right here in the sanctuary, we have our parent and youth meeting for the Appalachian Service Project. So if you have a youth or if you are a parent whose youth is interested, come join us tonight and learn more about that. Also, we have Holy Week coming up, and we have multiple things going on then. We're going to have Come and Go Communion here in the sanctuary with Pastor Robert and myself on Thursday evening. Friday evening, we're going to have our Good Friday service at 7 p.m., and then right after that, our prayer vigil will begin. So you can sign up to pray in the library for 30-minute slots from 7 p.m. on Friday all the way till midnight on Easter morning. So if you're interested in that, talk to me and I'll get you signed up for that. There's a lot of great early morning slots left, so if you're a 2 a.m. kind of person, we need you. We also have our Easter services. So the way this is going to work this year, our Saturday evening and our Sunday at 9 service will be the same, like they usually are, and then we'll have our sunrise service at 7. So there's 3 Easter services you can choose from: Saturday 5:30, Sunday at 9, or Sunday at 7 a.m. So lots of opportunities to come. We're not going to turn people away, but just come and worship our resurrected Savior. Also, next Sunday from 3 to 5 p.m. at the Wesley Center, we're hosting an event for you to come and make butterflies so that we can decorate our sanctuary for Easter. So we're going to have the gym open for kids who might want to play. This is for all ages, so you can come make a butterfly. Kids can go play. Parents and whoever wants to come can hang out. We'll have tables set up. You can have some time to fellowship, catch up with people. We'll have a trivia game. But all ages, this is for 0 to 110 years old. So please join us next Sunday from 3 to 5 p.m. And Becky Raver has an announcement.
Good morning. I am Becky Raber, and I am here to represent the staff parish committee from our church here. The church has had a great privilege to have Pastor Laura with us for the past 6 years. It's with great sadness that I am to announce that she is going to be leaving. Laura has taken a position as a bereavement coordinator at Heartland Hospice in Buffalo Grove. She will continue to be a clergy member of the annual conference appointed outside the local church.
So I'm gonna save my goodbye for later because that doesn't need to come right now. But I have to apologize. There is some miscommunication with the conference. And they published this information before we got a chance to announce it. So if you saw that online and were startled by that, I really apologize. That should not have happened. But the position starts on April 19th, so I will be there during the week starting then, but I will be here every weekend, most weekends, until mid-June. So I will continue to be in worship. I'll still be here for youth group, all that kind of stuff, until the new person is able to start. And we're really excited because we've talked to the conference about what the church might like to see in the next associate pastor, and so we're very excited, and we hope that they'll have an announcement for us in the next week or two, maybe three. Hopefully soon we'll know who's coming next, but I'm going to save my goodbyes for later. We're going to invite Steve to lead us in our first hymn with Cheryl.
I want to interrupt really quickly. We do want to have you keep your eye open. We are going to have a celebration for Laura, Brad, and Isabel, probably sometime in June, but keep your eye. We'll keep you posted as what you're going to be doing and when it will be.
Every hour, most gracious Lord, no tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now. My Savior, I come to Thee. I need Thee every hour. Teach me Thy will and Thy rich promises in me.
Take a brief breath as we enter into our space and our time for worshiping our God. Would you join me in our call to worship? O God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Because your steadfast love is like water in the middle of a desert, to us who are thirsty. I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands and call on your name. You have been my help in times of joy and in times of sorrow. My soul is satisfied as with a rich feast, and my mouth praises you with joyful lips. Would you join me in our unison prayer? Giver of the most expensive gift of all, help us to learn from you. May we who are so good at catering for our own wants make ourselves more vulnerable to the needs of others. Let us live unselfishly that we may spread love's fragrance wherever the odor of cynicism and despair hangs in the air. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Our scripture this morning is from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor. He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put in it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." This is the word of God for all the people of God. Thanks be to God. Steve, would you sing "Jesus Loves Me" for us?
Yes.
Thank you.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so.
Thank you. So in today's scripture, Mary offers probably the most valuable thing she owns for Jesus. So this bottle of nard, which was so expensive, it could have cost up to possibly a full year's wages. For this bottle of perfume. These are not rich people, so this is probably the most expensive possession that Mary has, and she gives it to Jesus. So today I brought with me a couple of items, and I was wondering who in your life you would be willing to give these things to. So the first thing I brought is this TV remote. So if you're sitting on the couch, you got your remote, who in your life would you be willing to give up control of this object to? If you would give up control of this to, let's see, your spouse, raise your hand. Okay, that's a sign of a good marriage there. Good job, Twyla and John, sharing the remote. Who would give up control of this to your child? Okay. Jacqueline's raising her hand. Jacqueline's like, yes, I take the remote. Who would give this up to? Maybe like you're having a dinner party and like your neighbor walks over and you don't know them real well, and would you just hand them a remote? Twyla would. Katie. Twyla's very generous with her remote. I have a couple other things. I have these, the key to my car. Who in your life would you be willing to hand over the keys to your car? Probably your spouse. How about your kids? Maybe one, maybe both. Maybe not both. Maybe depends on the kid. Okay. How about that neighbor situation again? You're a kind of weird neighbor you don't know real well, walks by. You gonna hand over your car keys? Oh, okay. Some people hand over their car keys. Some of you are very generous. I got here my phone. This is a pretty valuable thing I have. This is a big deal in my life, thinking about who I might give this to. And then I got one other thing that's probably closest to what Mary offered. Got my debit card here. How many of you would just hand this over to your child? Oh, okay. Some of you have very trustworthy children. How about your weird neighbor that you don't know real well? I'm going to give this to Steve. It's all yours. So Mary gives this incredibly valuable thing to Jesus, who is her very good friend. She gives all that she has, she gives to Jesus as a sign of her love and her trust in him. And when we think about the things that we have, the things that we own, the things that we hold valuable, thinking about giving some of those things away, like perfume is one thing. A bottle of perfume today, that's not, unless you're wearing like, I don't even know what an expensive perfume is. But that's not a big deal today. But if you think about what might be the equivalent of that and then handing that over to someone, that's a big deal. So today we're going to kind of talk about what does that kind of love look like, where we would give everything to Jesus, and maybe how that would lead us to give to other people too. And sometimes that can be a little scary, but Jesus gives all to us, and Mary responded by giving her all back to Jesus. Let's pray. Jesus, we're so grateful for all that you give to us, even your life. Jesus, help us to be grateful, and out of our gratitude, help us to give to others, and help us to give our love to you and back to the world. We pray in your name. Amen.
As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart, desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength and shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
Let's pray. God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts of each one of our hearts be worship to you. Help us to contemplate your love for us so we can love you in return. Amen. In my car, so Brad and I sold one of our cars this past year, one of the things I had to do before we sold that car was get a CD out of the CD drive. And this CD had been in there since 2011 without ever coming out. So this was a CD I really, really loved and listened to a lot. And one of the songs on that CD that I liked to play was from the early 2000s. And it has the refrain, "If I traded it all, if I gave it all away for one thing, just for one thing, wouldn't that be something?" And I love that song because it's not a Christian song, but it's a really good description of what faith is like. If I traded it all, if I gave it all away for one thing, wouldn't that be something? And I think this song describes this story in Scripture so well, the story of Mary and Jesus. Sometimes our faith kind of gets portrayed as a religion of rules or constraint. Like, you should do this, you shouldn't do that, you should stay away from that at all costs. Definitely you have to do this. Here's the rules you have to live by. But that description of faith isn't quite adequate, especially if we look at what Mary does on the sixth night before Passover. And if we hear what she's doing, it's not all about the rules. It's more about, if I gave it all away for one thing, if I loved so much that I gave it all for this one thing, for this one Jesus, what would that do? And that's what the life of faith is about. So kind of to give you some context, a lot of you know that nard, this perfume that Mary pours out, was the scent and the perfume that was used to embalm the dead in Jesus's time. So some of you know that, but I think some of the context we forget is that this point in Jesus's life, he is wanted. So there's, on the Grundy County Sheriff's page, they post pictures of people who are wanted for various crimes. So that's where Jesus is at. His picture's on Facebook, it's on the news. They are looking for Jesus. Right before this, Jesus had fled Judea because a crowd had tried to stone him, because he had called himself the Son of God. And so then Mary sends him a message that her brother Lazarus is dying. And so Jesus knows that he's wanted, knows that people want to kill him, and yet he risks his life to come back to Mary and to Martha and to raise Lazarus from the dead. So this is not just a miracle that Jesus performs. This is Jesus actually risking his freedom and his life to help this family, because the chief priests and the Pharisees have already decided that Jesus is way too dangerous to live, and they want to kill him. And so to be with the people that he loves, Jesus, in this moment, trades it all. He's giving it all away to be with these people that he loves instead of saving himself. So for Jesus, loving us isn't about rules or shoulds or shouldn'ts or being practical. It's about that one thing, that Jesus has eyes only for us, even when we sin, even though we're not perfect. Jesus gives it all for us. And so it's Jesus's extravagant love that draws Mary to do this thing where she pours out perfume on his feet. And this scene in Scripture is pretty scandalous. So Jesus and his disciples are eating at Mary and Martha and Lazarus's home. Jesus is a fugitive. Martha's dishing out dinner. Lazarus was just raised from the dead, so that's pretty amazing. And then Mary walks in. You know, they're all relaxing at the table. Mary walks in with this jar of nard, which cost maybe her entire earnings for the entire year. Maybe that was her entire savings plan, was this jar of ointment. And she pours the whole jar on Jesus' feet. And if you imagine what that would smell like, they say a little bit of nard goes a long way. It's kind of like Axe body spray, like a little bit goes a long way. But Mary has just poured an entire jar all over Jesus' feet. So there's this like tidal wave of scent that like pours out into the room. And then when the jar is empty and everything stinks, Mary takes her hair out of probably a very modest hairdo. She might have had a covering over her hair to be modest. But she takes that off. She unbraids her hair. She lets it fall over her shoulders, which is pretty scandalous in mixed company. And she leans over and she wipes Jesus' feet with her hair. And if you're thinking about, like, how would I feel giving over my remote to my spouse or my credit card to my neighbor or my my car keys to my child, and how vulnerable that makes you feel? What Mary has just done is just dumped her life savings on Jesus' feet and then shown him her hair and, like, touched him in this really strange way. So you think about how it makes you feel to share your remote, and then we think about what Mary has just shared and how crazy that is. And so Mary has just shown her utter faith and her utter love for Jesus. And she's doing that in response to what Jesus has given to her first. So Jesus has risked his life to help her family out of love. And now she's giving back this gift to him. So it's hard to say that faith is about restraint and rules. Not that rules aren't important, but it's hard to say that rules are the main part of our faith when this is our example of discipleship, that Mary is breaking all the rules to show her love for this person. So Mary's story is a story of being transformed through God's extravagant love. And if you look back through Scripture, that's really what we see. That's what we see God doing. God is not offering us carefully reasoned arguments. God is not offering us ways to feel better about that we're really good and they're really bad. What God is doing all throughout Jesus' life is showing these massive displays of love. Jesus turning water into wine at Cana, that there's more than the group even needs. Jesus feeding 5,000 people with a bunch of leftovers. So God is getting our attention by loving us so passionately and extravagantly that it breaks all the rules. So here in John, we have a story about this extravagantly loving God who lavishes love on us, and a story about Mary who in response to that, breaks all the rules to love Jesus. And as Christ followers, we're walking in Mary's footsteps. Mary's walking in Christ's footsteps. We're walking in her footsteps. And that's easy to say that, you know, we live lives of love and that's great. It's a kind of a nice sentiment. But when you think about what that really means and how risky that is, you know, when Jesus lived his life this way, it got him killed. When we live our lives that way, we're saying that it's not fear or war or politics or power or might that changes the world. We're saying that it's love. And that's really scary because we're saying, I'm not going to try to put all my faith in these other things. I'm gonna risk my life that God's love will change the world. And that is a scary thing to do. So Judas recognizes that this is a scary thing to do. And Judas says, what Mary has done is such a waste. It's embarrassing. It's an excuse for the disciples to ignore their responsibility to the poor. And Judas says that that in loving Jesus so much, Mary is going to neglect to serve others. And I think underneath that, Scripture says that Judas is a thief, and that's why he doesn't like this. But I think the other thing that's going on here is that Judas is embarrassed by what Mary's done. It's embarrassing to see a woman take her hair out and wipe this guy's feet. It's embarrassing to him to see that these rules are being broken, and she loves so much that this is her. This is how she's responding. I think Judas thinks that's shameful. Extravagant love is risky. It does break the rules. And I think Judas knows that, and he's responding out of that fear and that sense of embarrassment and shame. For Judas, it is the power, it is the might that changes things. And Jesus is saying otherwise, and Mary is saying otherwise. So I think that extravagant love is risky, not because it makes us neglect others, like Judas says, but because it makes us love people more, even people we're told we shouldn't love or shouldn't care about. Jesus knows that Mary's love isn't going to stop with Jesus. If Jesus thought that Mary was doing this and she was never going to love anyone else because she just spent all her love on Jesus, I don't think Jesus would have approved of that. Jesus knows that Mary's not out of love. Once Mary's opened her heart to God, her heart has to be open to all of God's children, and that includes the poor. So when we're open to God, when we love Jesus like this, we start to love others in extravagant ways too. It might look like Mother Teresa giving her life and her energy to serve the poor and the dying. It might look like anointing the feet of refugees and welcoming them. It might look like looking past someone's appearance or the different clothes they wear or the different foods they eat or the different language they speak to see their worth and their beauty. It might look like hearing past someone's offensive language to hear what is in their heart. It might look like listening to someone's story and hearing what's important to them, even if the way they live breaks some of the rules that we think Christians should keep. But listening to them anyway, because we love them, because we love Jesus. It might look like instead of the first reaction being to point fingers or to gossip or to shake our finger at someone, looking for ways to admire and to encourage, because if we love Jesus and Jesus loves this person, what does that say about my response to them? So all of those actions are risky. To look past someone's appearance, to love someone who breaks the rules, to look at someone's heart instead of just their outward interactions with the world. All of those things are hard, but that's the way God calls us to love. There's a story that Fred Craddock, he's a preacher from many years ago, he tells a story about risky, extravagant love when he visited Ireland. And so he tells this story, when my wife and I visited Ireland, we noticed behind the farmers' homes, there would be little yards. And in one of those yards, there was a donkey, like some people would keep a dog, just kind of hanging out in the backyard. And I'd said to the people in the cottage, oh, you're still using a donkey to work your fields? And the farmer said, no, we have a motorized plow to work the field. And Fred said, but I see that you still have your donkey. And the farmer said, oh yeah, you know, the donkey pulled our plow for many years, and we don't need him now, but we would never get rid of him. That donkey is part of the family. You mean you just keep that donkey and you feed him and you take care of him and you pay his vet bills and he's not giving you anything back? Yep. But why? Isn't that expensive? Yes, it can be expensive, but we really love our donkey. Sometimes love is beyond the practical. It goes beyond the rules that we think we should live by. It goes beyond what it seems like it would be the most logical thing to do. Sometimes love changes the rules, and it makes you risk quite a lot to take care of someone you love. So when we love like that, we can see beyond the rules that call us to judge each other, and we respond with curiosity instead of confusion, or open hearts instead of anger, or appreciation instead of fear. And when we do that, the world looks a lot more beautiful. Where we saw stupidity or ugliness, the world looks like a place of sorrow and tragedy, people who are genuinely struggling, not people who are stupid and lost. Where the world looked like it was weird and unfathomable, it becomes a place of diversity and beauty. So as we get to the end of Lent, I think the question Mary has for us is, what would it be like to love Jesus so much that that love overflows for others? What would it look like to, instead of choosing to lean into hatred or disdain or judgment, to lean instead into loving Jesus more? What would that look like in our interactions with other people if we consciously made that turn? Every time we felt ourselves looking at someone and saying, I don't get you, you're ruining everything, the country can't handle you, you're breaking all the rules. What would it look like instead if we made that conscious turn to saying, Jesus, I love you so much? How would we turn back to those people and see them differently? When Jesus is our one thing that we'd give everything for, that love pours out into our lives in extraordinary ways, and Christ's love shines in corners we never thought was possible. Amen. What are some of the joys and concerns you have on your hearts this morning? We're not used to sharing joys and concerns in church anymore. I have a couple things. First of all, Linnell DePong sponsored the radio broadcast this morning, and Clyde and Barb Chandler sponsored the altar flowers, and those are in memory of their niece, Lauren Chandler Roth. So we thank them and we pray for their niece, Lauren, and her family. Also, we have a rosebud on the altar, and that is to celebrate the birth of Theo Mason McDonald. That's Alec and Mickey McDonald's son. He was born on the 3rd of March, and he's very cute. So we celebrate the birth of Theo and pray for his family as they welcome him. What other prayers? Yes, Joyce. Yay! I have another Awesome. Joyce has another great granddaughter, number 10. And what's her name? Penny. Baby Penny. And can I share your news about Norma? Is that okay? Okay. So we were praying for Joyce's sister, Norma, who the doctors thought had cancer. And it turns out that it was not cancer. And so it is something treatable. And so we're celebrating with Joyce and Norma. Yes, that is a huge answer to prayer. Other prayer requests. We are praying for Bruce and Julie Smith. Bruce had surgery on a brain tumor this week. So please pray for him. He has a long road ahead of recovery. And Julie is Janelle Hankins' daughter, and Bruce is her husband. Last night we prayed for Joel. That's Judy Munson's son, and we prayed for Judy. We're also praying for Shar Potts. Shar has been in the hospital with a very serious infection and was on a vent, but she is starting to open her eyes and to recover from that. And today is her birthday, so her son Chris has asked that we pray, but also if you have Shar's number, that you would text her happy birthday or a picture so that when she's able to use her phone, she can open it up and there's all these birthday greetings. So please pray for Shar, text her if you can, and we celebrate that she's getting better. We're also praying, we had a prayer request from Terry Olson. Terry wanted to pray for the shootings in Atlanta, the victims of that shooting, the Asian American women who were killed in those attacks. And she also, I asked if I could read what she said. Terry said, please pray for the people in our country, that we learn to see our neighbors through our hearts instead of through our eyes. We seem to have trouble dealing with anyone who doesn't resemble the face we see in the mirror. So I thought that was good words. So we pray for the ones who were killed in Atlanta and their families, and also for our country. Yeah, Jen. Thank you for your prayers for us, too. We appreciate that. Yeah, this church has been very good to us, and this has been our home, and we love it. We still love it here. All right, would you join me as we enter our time of prayer? And I should have given control of my phone to one of you because I left it over here and there's some prayer requests on it. So Diane Lincoln shares a prayer of joy that on match day, Katie, her daughter, Katie Lincoln, matched at Indiana University in Indianapolis for residency in OBGYN. So she says, thank you for the prayers and encouragement all throughout medical school. And then Karen Gladden has a joy of thankfulness for safe travels. They've been on a trip to Florida. And also asked for prayers for her son's neighbor, Suzanne, who lost her 3-year battle with cancer. And she was 49 and leaves a 13-year-old daughter. So we will pray for Suzanne's family. Let's pray. Jesus, as we turn our eyes to you, as we learn to love you, we learn to love our neighbors as ourselves. We learn to love our neighbors, more importantly, as you love them. God, we pray that as we learn to love you, that our prayers would expand, that our cares would expand, that we would pay attention and lift up those who surround us near and far, that our concerns would be theirs and theirs would be ours. And that we would lift them up in our love for them and our love for you. God, this morning we especially pray for the Smiths, for Bruce and for Julie. We pray for Janelle and their family. We pray for Joel and for Judy. We give thanks for Norma's healing and for the birth of baby Penny and baby Theo. God, we lift up Shar and pray for her continued recovery. God, we lift up the family of Suzanne, and we celebrate with Doug and Karen their safe travels. And God, we celebrate Katie and her gifts and pray that Indiana would be a good place for her to grow. God, we lift up the people of Atlanta. We pray for your comfort on the families who have had sons and daughters murdered. God, we pray that you would open our eyes, each one of us, so that as we see each other, we see your children and not people to fear or to hate. God, where we see that hatred, we pray that you would give us the courage to confront it. For all of these prayers and all the prayers that are on our hearts, the ones named and the ones that have just been held in silence, God, we lift them to you as we pray the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We are so grateful for all who continue to give, whether it's here in worship or through the electronic banking system or just by mail, and all who give their prayers and their gifts. It's been a lot of Methodists who have been serving at the vaccine clinics. Now it's mostly the National Guard, but up until then, it was Methodist faces you would see a lot. So all the ways that you guys have continued to give through the blood drives, the serving at clinics, reaching out to each other in so many ways that we don't even know about. I know so much of that has gone on, and we are so grateful that you have continued to be the church. I wanted to lift up especially the Appalachian Service Project today. We like to lift up a ministry each time we have our time of offering. And it's been a long two years since last we were able to go. I still have the bracelet that Dr. Jen made from our last trip. And so that promise of being able to go back this year, the hope that that will work out, we are so excited for that. And so grateful for the ways that the church supports that ministry and for the ways that Ryan continues to lead that, even in these uncertain times. It's a lot of work, and so we're grateful. Would you stand as you are able as Steve leads us in our doxology?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Gracious God, your love pours out for us in unimaginable ways. Help our hearts to be grateful for all that you give to us. Help us to notice the blessings in our lives, the big ones and the small ones and the in-between ones. And God, as we see those blessings, help us to reach out and to be a blessing to others in our lives, the ones near and the ones far. We pray this in the name of your Son. Amen. You may be seated.
Of mercy never. for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God, he to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Extravagant love is risky. Love for our neighbors is risky. But love Jesus and let that love lead you in courage, in stepping across boundaries and breaking the rules to give that love to all you meet. Go forth and love in the name of God, our Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.